Welcome once again to The Radical Imagination. I'm your host, Jim Vrettos, and I'm a sociologist at John Jay College here in New York City. Each Sunday evening on MNN, we try to offer an opportunity to wonder, imagine, and work toward a world of radical possibilities. We want to offer a safe house, if you will, a time and space where progressive alternative narratives rooted in radical love, economic, political, ecological, racial, and gender justice become possible in our minds and in practice. Communism has been academically and rather dryly defined as a political doctrine in which human society can be organized on the basis of common ownership of economic resources by the direct producers, our workers. Endlessly debated and analyzed as to its origins and which tradition is the purest, severely maligned, and seen as an ultimate threat to the economic and political status quo, it has also captured the hearts and minds of countless millions around the world as a system that would save them from endless misery and exploitation. The activist Cornel West has argued that the fundamental thrust of Marxism, despite the numerous brutalities perpetuated by Marxist regimes, is the self-fulfillment, self-development, and self-realization of harmonious personalities. For Cornel, Marxism is a child of 19th century Romanticism, to the extent that it subscribes to a steadfast hope in an earthly paradise, and invests in a politics and a passion previously monopolized by Christianity. Well, this evening I'm pleased to welcome Jarvis Tyner to this evening's show. He's a longtime American activist and the current executive vice chair of the Communist Party USA. In 1972 and 1976, Jarvis ran on the Communist Party ticket for vice president of the United States. So I'm so happy to have you here, Jarvis. It's a pleasure.
Good to be here.
And we need your help in understanding this tremendous tradition, often maligned, but often very hopeful tradition that so many people look for as a vehicle through which their lives can improve. Because is this going to be an earthly paradise, or we're confused about all this? Trump says that Bernie is a communist. Yeah. So. Thank you so much for being here and helping us out understand all
this. Let's clear this up. Bernie is not a communist. He's a great man.
He's a great man.
And he's a very honest socialist. It's exactly what he says he is. Mm-hmm. And he's good for this country. It's wonderful. But at the same time, communists are not in any way hostile to what he's doing, even though it's different than our perspective, perhaps here and there. At this current time, it is a good perspective to fight for the things that he's laid out there.
Interesting.
Okay. You see, the party has never been, angry or isolated from those fighting for democracy, because we ultimately believe that in order to achieve the first stage, socialism, and certainly the last stage, communism, the ultimate stage, it requires full participation of the people. You're not going to impose socialism on people, and you're not going to force them to accept free medical care and all that, and
right,
all the things
right,
that
get. Right.
And for those who have tried that, it didn't work. So, and certainly,
was it your own tradition?
Yeah,
the authoritarian.
Yeah. I understand why, though, because the first socialist country, the Soviet Union, was under severe attack. And 16 nations invaded the Soviet Union. People don't know that our United States has invaded the Soviet Union as part of 16 nations to bring down the new socialist or Bolshevik government. And they failed in their attack and so forth, but it did instill a sense of defensiveness, and we got the whole world's against us, we got to fight, and so on. And even as the Soviet presence and support of national liberation around the world, and support of workers' movements around the world, which was substantial, both politically, ideologically, diplomatically, and in the national liberation movement quite materially. You know, they really, I was in Vietnam during the the war, not as a soldier, as a peace on a peace delegation. I saw the U.S. bombing, but I also saw the great resistance of the Vietnamese people, and really the aid from the Soviet Union was decisive. But at the same time, you know, there are weaknesses. Yeah.
Tell us, gosh, we could spend all many shows on this, but start. Give us some history of the concept of communism, what it means, and also tell us about the origins of the Communist Party of the USA, 1919, right? It's the largest Communist Party in the country and so on, and your involvement in it. But where does this concept, this idea of communism, come from? It certainly sounded very academic and dry.
Well, so, I think it's drawn from ancient history and the development of early societies.
Hunting societies.
Hunting and gathering, even societies, yes. And it is as well based on the basic theories of Marx and Engels in regard to modern capitalism, how it worked, what was wrong with it, what it defined as progress and wealth, how it's accumulated, who creates the wealth.
It's about sharing the wealth.
So ultimately, communists said the workers create the wealth, but they don't get the benefit of the wealth, and how to create a society which would make that possible, and therefore to socialize ownership of the means of production and distribution, laid the basis to guarantee that the wealth would be shared, and so on.
So a working class revolution, workers taking over control of the means of production.
Right.
That's because there is this historical class struggle, takes all kinds of forms, different points of history, and the only way that true economic justice will occur is through that completion of that struggle through the workers' revolution.
I think that's the absolute strict definition.
Okay.
But in life, you know, it matures, it is designed to fit the circumstances. That's where dialectics and all that comes in, of the objective circumstances in each country. So the Soviet experience, it cannot be a blueprint for us. We've got to find our way to this new society our own way, and with our own, from our own history, psychology, experience, culture, and all that.
The Russian experience was quite a traumatic one. My
grandparents
came from Russia, and I can still remember my grandfather telling me the unbelievable, brutal conditions the Russian peasant was under, and the escape that he made from that situation. So, you're right. So each particular state or nation has to understand the struggle in different ways. Is that what?
Well, yeah, and the world changes, and it has changed considerably since 100 years ago, when the Russian people fought there and established their revolution. We live in a country where the right to vote, although it's all constantly challenged, but the right to vote has a long tradition. Everybody expects to be able to vote and have political choices and so forth. So I don't think we can have a one-party state like they did. So why should, that in their historic context, you got to see why they did that. But on the other hand, that is not something we can do. And so concepts of dictatorship of the proletarian, what I would call full democracy, full democratic, where the people literally helped run society from a position of strength, that has to be defined based on the American experience and so forth. And we communists feel that the transition to socialism can be peaceful. It can be peaceful.
And you do take into account the American, as you say, American populist experience. And, and that has not been true among all, you know, American communists before, is that? So do you represent a particular, I don't want to get too technical, branch or stream of thinking that is now more widespread within the party, would you say?
Well, if you go back to the writings and the reading and the strategies in the 20s, very, very sectarian.
Right.
The 30s, this party sort of pioneered around the world by building broad democratic united fronts, which resulted in the greatest progress in many ways for the working class. They organized the trade union movement, They saved the Scottsboro. They started the whole fight against Jim Crow and so on.
The 30s and 40s was incredibly active. Big.
And then the anti-fascists, they went to Spain, you know, and so forth. Party got huge. It was had a large size. Probably not by today's standard, but by that, those standards back then, it was a very large and influential party. Elected Benjamin J. Davis as the city council here in Harlem, Peter V. Caccione, city council in Brooklyn. It had other elected officials across the country. And during the Second World War, when the Soviet Union was our ally and really turned the tide of the war against the Nazis who were out to destroy them, and powerful forces here were hoping they would succeed, and then they could negotiate, they thought, but they were dealing with a beast that they had not defined properly, understood properly. And so when the Soviets won and turned the tide of the war, and then, of course, there was a united front which ultimately defeated fascism, a great contribution to humanity, unbelievable.
Yes,
but the, still many died.
The number of millions and millions, of course, disproportionately.
But it's they died so that we would not go through that again. That's why people get a little nervous about people like Trump and the way they talk, and the notion that all he had to do is be a strong man and make a lot of money and show his muscle and never give in to anybody and not negotiate. That and when you had a powerful economic and military power like the United States talking like that, you know what the rest of the world is saying? The F word comes to mind. And I mean, not the four-letter one, but that too.
We're on the table here. I think we can say these things. But but so, now again, the struggle, as you say, the invasion of Russia after its revolution, the constant pressure by capitalist forces, particularly in America, to try to control and dominate, make sure it wouldn't spread. Why, again, seems fairly obvious, but why don't you tell us why this is such a an important issue for capitalists? Why has communism been so much of a scapegoat?
You know, it's really capitalism that convinces people that something like communism and socialism is necessary. You know, when the people in the Deep South were under Jim Crow, these folks came from the North. I'm talking in the 1930s when the Klan was powerful.
Right.
And racist terror was just ran everything, you know, local sheriffs, everything, the governors and everything, the National Guard. People went down there to organize trade unions, to organize black and white poor people. Case of Angelo Herndon in Georgia, he was from Atlanta, he was a young communist, he went into organize, he was organizing a march of black and white poor people, rural poor people in Alabama. And he was charged with sedition, and he faced the death penalty. The sedition law organized anybody black or white go back to slavery and Jim Crow. It was a Jim Crow law from slavery. And he was charged with sedition, and the penalty was murder. This was what these communists did when they went south. They organized a steel union down in Birmingham. But in his case, a young attorney who came, an African-American attorney who came from a wealthy family. His father owned two or three black newspapers across the South. His name was Benjamin J. Davis. I mentioned him before.
He's
one of my heroes.
Right.
Came out of Harvard Law, one of the first people to graduate Harvard Law. Black student, one of the first black students at Amherst College, went to Harvard Law. Came home, young guy, and he was practicing his law. He heard about this case. Oh, I'll take that case. And he took that case, and he had never experienced the level of racism that he experienced there. The judge used the N-word, called him boy and all that. And he lost the case, but he saved his life in a sense that he got him to the next level of appeal and ultimately to the Supreme Court. That guy had to leave the South, Ben Davis, and he came here. And he joined the Communist Party in the course of defending a communist that he had never met. So you know what I'm saying? Capitalism, the brutality of the judge. He's a guy who had a privileged life. But the poverty he saw and the conditions under which people were living, the repressive conditions, made him examine capitalism. And in defense of Angelo Herndon, he ultimately joined the party. He ultimately came here. He was the editor of our newspaper. And then he became worked in Harlem, worked side by side with Adam Clayton Powell. And eventually, when Adam Clayton Powell went to Congress, he asked Ben to be the search committee to find somebody to take his city council seat. And after a few weeks of Ben looking around and reporting to him, he said, Ben, let's face it, you're the guy you ought to take my seat. And Adam Clayton Powell supported Ben Davis. to be the second African American on a New York City council. That's the kind of guy, quality of leadership he was. And he worked with the churches, he worked with civic, fraternal organizations, women's groups, youth groups all over the Harlem area. He was a wonderful, wonderful, that is the greatest example
the
of our success.
The moral integrity that, and the commitment that transcends labels here and a narrow definition, I guess, and that's what you're saying about Sanders too. But help us also understand, people here, socialism, communism, what is the difference here in these terms?
Well, socialism is the first stage, and it essentially is from each, based on their labor.
So Marx believed that there were certain stages of history, right?
Yeah. That took, and, they, and therefore...
That was involved in a dialectic, right?
Yeah.
Conflict
between ultimately, he said, though, that the socialism means that will produce really people's ownership of the basic means of production.
Okay. And as that, capitalism... Right, and help me out on this
one,
right, destroys itself through its excessive greed and
exploitation,
mendacity and exploitation.
Racism.
Inequality and so on, which, of course, we're experiencing now in this country. Absolutely.
And actually, if you study Marx's political economy, ultimately what capitalism does is devour itself in the sense that it so impoverishes the working class that the ability of the society to grow and be prosperous is cut short. And so what they forget is that the workers are also the largest group of consumers.
Yeah.
And so that's one of the contradictions that capitalism cannot solve as long as profit is their main motive. And profit
of course, there could be other markets in other countries. But
so, well, then they go to other countries and do the same thing and worse. That's imperialism.
Right.
So my original point being that it isn't so much that some doctrinaire guy comes along and convinces you that you got to do this. Life is what brings people to socialism and communism. That's what brought me, and that's what brought millions of people around the world. And to me, I was coming out of high school in Philadelphia, born in the ghetto. My parents both grew up as sharecroppers in North Carolina, came north. They were part of that 6 million African Americans who escaped Jim Crow, the greatest migration, as they say.
Yep.
They came to Philadelphia. My mother worked as a day worker. My father worked in a factory. Father was a Second World War vet. My mother eventually went to beauty culture school, opened up a beauty shop, and that's where I grew up, but in a very poor neighborhood. We were a little better off. She had a business, although sometimes you wondered whether people were worse off now because it was tough. So from that, I got my first political education sitting in my mother's beauty shop and hearing these African-American women who worked as domestic workers and on garment industry and so forth discussing life that they were experiencing, how mean people were to them. And they would find some bosses that were nice and all that how in general they were in a oppressive condition. And I'm just a kid, you know, 6, 7 years old, but it's like having a big impact on me. In 1950, when they killed the Rosenbergs, you should have heard discussion in my mother. These are not communists, in the beauty shop. First of all, you know, Ethel took two shots from the electric chair. And that's the thing that they hung on, because they had this thing, I don't know if it's biblical or something, that if you didn't die from the first attempt to kill you, execute you,
right,
if that didn't work, then God meant for you to get out of there, and they should have let that mother of two children go. That was really, and I'm sitting, I can remember some, because these ladies were articulate.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm sitting, I'm at school listening to what they're saying. And so they said that was wrong, that was so tragic. And when they were firing teachers in Philadelphia in the 50s, those who were communists, my brother and I had great teachers. And they were among those fired, and we just didn't understand it. And our parents went up and beat them. They were nice people, dedicated. Some of these teachers didn't give a heck about you. And they would just, if you weren't doing well, oh, he's no good. That one can't learn. That's something wrong with that kid and so forth. I went through that cycle already as a kid. And my mother was a school teacher in the South before she came up to Philadelphia and got her degree in beauty culture in Oakland. She went to become a beautician. That was a higher calling for her at that time. Mm-hmm. That's what she wanted. Mm-hmm. So these teachers don't show real, because they come by the house. They talk to my mother with respect and so forth. They were the ones that were fired because of the
so those very personal experiences laid the foundation for then you're joining the party. You were 20, right?
I was 20 in 1961.
Okay.
Yeah.
And you again were attracted again from these initial experiences to the ideas and what were you doing then? You were organizing.
You know, I came out of high school and the family situation was very financially very tight.
Right.
And I had to go to work. So they had no junior college. I took a commercial course in high school, so I just went out and looked for work. It was 27% unemployment. I looked it up one the year for among black youth when I came out of high school. So I had a hard time finding a job. I finally ended up paying for a job. You know, they have these employment agencies. You get a job, but they take 3 weeks of your pay to pay it off. And I took that job, and it was a hard job. But I was so happy to have it. I made a dollar an hour, dollar and a quarter, or dollar a quarter for $1.50 for time and a half. And I worked really, really hard, and it was really exploiting me and so on. Meantime, the Civil Rights Revolution is raging, you know. I came out in 59, 60, was the Greensboro sit-in. Mm-hmm. Kids out in Berkeley, California were fighting against HUAC. Mm-hmm. There were all kinds, you know, you had Roe v.
Free
Wade.
Free speech.
Yeah, not Roe v. Wade. The Board of Education thing. Brown versus Board of Education, thank you. Mm-hmm. And you had this whole beginning of this massive new surge for civil rights, and I wanted to be a part of it. Meantime, I got into a union on my job, and it was I was in the printing industry then. The union was a craft union, and there were hardly any African Americans out of a local of about 1,500, only three of us. But I got in, I learned the trade and so forth, and then I got laid off. Mm. And then I got laid off, I started doing civil rights work. I ran to these great people who were fighting civil rights, black and white, and young, and I really liked it.
Which organizations were you?
Well, the first thing I did was the boycott of Woolworths as a result of the sit-ins in Greensboro, North Carolina.
Right.
So I just went up and joined the pickle. I didn't know who they were.
Right.
But
didn't make right.
Yeah, but you had CORE and NAACP and other groups that were active in those various struggles. In my case, I happened to join a group in West Philadelphia that was actually led by young communists. I didn't know it, but they were, and they were I hadn't met people like that. I went to an integrated high school, to be honest with you, although by the time I graduated, it was almost not integrated at all. But I met some decent white youth and white people, but.
What were they doing? What were these young communists doing in Philadelphia?
They were doing civil rights activities in the area. They were also active in disarmament issues. I had first heard about people doing something like that, and they were pro. They doing things like strike support and things. But they were all kinds of labor. And Philly was a big industrial town back then, not now, but it was then. And they would give out material at the plant gates, and they would hold socials and they would hold study groups, film things and dances and all this other thing. Mm. And I just fit right in, and I thought it was good. These people were good and they're well intended. I didn't know they were socialists or communists or anything at first, but when I found out, it made sense. All those things I was listening to in my mother's beauty shop, and my brother also was very influential, and he was a jazz musician, and he was very active in that culture. And a lot of them were Muslim, and a lot of them had a kind of progressive nationalism and through their understanding of Islam and so on. But mainly what they had was an anti-capitalism, which I picked up. And the way the FBI harassed Charlie Parker and all the great jazz people used the drug issue to destroy them, really, and put them in prison and all that. And so I was learning, hearing all that knowledge there too. So to me, being in a protest organization, or a radical opposition organization that wasn't crazy.
It
was natural. Right. I found my way there. And we, at the time in Philadelphia, we had a sizable black, but not many Latinos. There weren't that many Latinos there, but black and membership. But it was majority white. But they were nice young people. A high percentage of Jewish youth, too, as well, which came from the Holocaust and all of that. You know, come on. You go through something like that, you're going to find some way to fight this thing. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And obviously, communism had an appeal. So that's how I got in. Then I got into a union in a manufacturing place. I became a Teamster and so forth. And I saw the relation. I was doing civil rights work on my off hours and working to bring a union into my plant, which I did. And we made furniture. That's what I was doing then. And then eventually we formed a new youth organization called the W.E.B. Du Bois Club, named after the great scholar and political activist.
Black activist, yeah.
And I was asked.
Who joined the, 1961?
61, I joined the party.
He joined too.
He joined that, so yeah, him and I joined the same year. He called me up, okay. He said, Jarvis, what are you doing this weekend?
Okay. And you joined, okay.
I joined.
So when you joined, you tell us you go to meetings. What was going on there?
Then the party was semi-legal or semi-illegal.
Okay.
And, but it was kind of exciting
for young people. Because after McCarthy and so on.
The McCarran Act was in effect then.
Okay.
And when I joined.
So we're in the early 60s now.
Yeah, the early 60s. When I joined, the McCarran Act had provision that if you are a member of the Communist Party USA, every day you do not publicly say you're a communist and a spy, therefore, for Russia. That was the definition they put out.
Loyalty oath. What do you mean, every day?
Every day. The penalties on the McCarran Act were that every day that you didn't say you were register as a communist, that's the trade.
Right, okay.
And therefore a Soviet agent, you got 10 years in jail and a $10,000 fine. Mm. So in other words, in the course of a week, I'm done. So
yeah,
I had no money, and I've got 70 years in jail.
Yes, exactly, yeah.
So,
and
but
a month
I felt that these were people of goodwill. And they were self-sacrificing and sincere, and their
so it was like quasi-underground, or sort of you all met, but wasn't really
we worked
strategized formally, informally, just
we had organizations that we built,
resisting and surviving somehow.
Yeah. But we were doing more than that. We were growing actually, and because we were doing some good work in the civil rights movement, we made some great friends, and in the peace movement, and similarly, we made great friends. And many of them would join us. But when we had our club meetings, they had our phones tapped.
Right.
That's not the way it is now.
It isn't, okay.
No, but we would literally get in our car to go to a meeting, and all of a sudden we got a tail. Mm. And then when we had a little way of doing it. We'd go to one place, one person's house, park our car, and everybody would go in, and then we'd go out the back and go somewhere else for the meeting. And but when we came back, they had write down our license plate number and so forth. And none of us went to jail because the McCarran Act was defeated, because we stood up and we didn't give in, we didn't cave in. Mm-hmm. We challenged it in the court. We had a wonderful lawyers led by John Apt, the great John Apt, who defended us. He made some just great legal tactics and proved this law to be unconstitutional. It had a provision, by the way, Title II, that allowed the federal government to make a list of people who they considered un-American or not secure or threat to security. And at a given executive order from the president, that list, which were thousands of people, tens of thousands, those people could be rounded up and put in internment camps, concentration camps, or whatever you want to call it, jail.
Yeah.
They could be put
the
in
HUAC,
there. Had a similar provision?
Yeah, also.
Well, this was McCarran Act, and they had this provision. And that provision was knocked out. They also had another provision that said we couldn't have passports if a public communist, you fill out your application and everything. If you didn't say you were a communist, or if you did say you were a communist, you would not get a passport. That provision was knocked out. I think it was around Paul Robeson, where he wasn't publicly a member of the party, but a very, very close ally and friend, and many people.
And the party is seen as a vehicle to help bring about or direct as what? A vanguard effort to bring about socialism.
That's how we defined it, yes.
Yeah. And so as you begin to see and feel, experience all these injustices, and people are just naturally gravitating collectively to try to find some sort of way of resisting and changing all this, the party becomes an important focus. Certainly it was highly influential, as you've pointed out, in the 30s and 40s. What was your membership then? Close to 100,000?
At the peak, at its peak. About 100,000.
Okay.
And I think or 30 or 40,000 were young communists as well. But young communists become old communists, so they go to the party, but it's a transitional stage. But yeah, it was quite large. And this was the time when the propaganda apparatus of the ruling class, the big corporations and so forth, was not as sophisticated as now, was not as comprehensive. I mean, you could walk down East Street corner in Harlem and there'd be a communist or a socialist or a nationalist giving a speech, you know, and that was the way you communicated. And
a lot of the energy of the 60s among young people go, as you say, certainly King, sudden stages, phase of the civil rights movement, and the New Left, which had reservations about the old established left. So the problems were there, the crises and so on, but a lot of people, especially young people, gravitated toward these new outlets. And so what was the Communist Party trying to do? And what is it trying to do now? And we want to get up to what?
Yeah,
what,
absolutely.
Because I know you're
back in the 60s when the New Left emerged.
Right.
We had some differences with their concept of social change, and we also challenged them because a lot of them embraced anti-communism and the Cold War. Because part of the thing they were trying to say is, we're fighting for a new society, but we don't you dare accuse us of being with the socialists or the communists. That's not us, we're different. And so they called themselves the New Left, but it was defensive against all that hell of the anti-communism that came down in the 50s. And because when we went to work with SDS or any of the Panthers too, as militant as they were, they were not necessarily anti-communism. They embraced some of
it. They talked about revolutionary liberation movements, but wasn't
third world
interesting? What third world and all that? But it wasn't they wasn't as explicitly anti-communist as your organization was, right? So they parted ways with you.
Now, I wouldn't say they parted ways. I would say their public presence was that they did not challenge anti-communism.
Okay.
And
all right.
The worst future.
As you did.
Yeah, and we did. But also, they saw through the vision of the third world, too, a lot of them. And then Panthers said, you know, we joined the brothers and sisters in Vietnam who are fighting and blah, 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 and Africa and so on. But they didn't necessarily see the material role that was played by the Eastern European socialist countries and, China, everybody was trying to help the liberation movement. And they didn't see that. And therefore, they didn't want to recognize that because they felt they would lose their base or lose support and so on. And part of it was that they were attached to the AFL-CIO, the SDS was anyway.
Yeah, yeah.
And their initial funding and so forth came from the Industrial Union Department of AFL-CIO, and that department was really notoriously headed by anti-communist, and CIA had an influence.
Meany
and Kirkland, and that whole crowd.
So it must have been very disappointing for you.
What?
For this sort of, you know, struggle, that it would have been made a big difference if there could have been more of a united front there.
Yeah, but we were making that difference. We were trying to make that difference. That was part of the challenge, you know what I'm saying?
Of course,
you know, sometimes it was these forces blocked us or whatever. But, you know, we had friends in SDS that wanted to work with us and that we would go see, talk to, and all for some people.
I have to tell you that we're hoping that one of our shows coming up pretty soon, May 4th, taping, Tom Hayden will be
Skyping. Yeah, Tom. Yeah, exactly.
He's people good, like Tom. And one of the co-hosts of the show is Stanley Aronowitz.
Oh, okay.
So we are open to these debates, and so it's fascinating to hear the struggles that you're talking about.
So here. For me, I wasn't in a little room, you know, depressed about this. I was just excited to be fighting it, I was just excited that little me and my little group and everything, that we could stand up to this very powerful. So we went after J. Edgar Hoover, and he's not going to tell us what we can read and what we can study and tell us the parameters of our political thinking and all that. We went on campuses, we talked to people, we formed a group after the Du Bois call called the Young Workers Liberation League. I was the national chairman of that, the first national chairman of that. We had a chance to travel around the world and so forth. Angela Davis case came in and the party exploded.
Tell us a little about that. Tell us a little about that.
Well, connection. They thought that they had us politically in a situation where they could destroy the party with Angela by saying, well, she arranged the shooting and so forth. She had nothing to do with it. Total frame up. Every major mass publication magazine had her on the front cover as a fugitive, because when they went to blame her, she went underground and
she was a member of the party.
Absolutely.
This was a strategy to
And the party and intimidate the left. And they had gotten away with a lot of that with this Cointel. All these other people. We were victims of it in Philadelphia.
Right.
I got arrested by a plainclothes Red Squad guy, and taken in. And they were doing all kinds of conspiratorial things. They were playing on the race issue. They broke couples up. They said, don't go in that organization. The people are interracially married in there. They told nationalists that, so don't work with them. But the nationalists said, no, they're out with us. Yeah. Girard College in Philadelphia was segregated, and we were part of the people picketing out there. It's in the middle of the North Philadelphia ghetto. But Stephen Girard said only white male orphans could go to school there. So we were NAACP, people were working, we were doing that, got involved in. And so we were having a ball.
Yeah, it sounds like, I'm just in awe of your energy and the excitement you bring. And I'm thinking also of those, of you at 6 and 7 listening to these stories in the beauty shop, because they really, I think, formed so much of this passion and energy that's kept you going for your whole life.
One thing I learned later, I understood later, is that the fight against racism, and especially from the racially oppressed, but not exclusively just from them, from everybody who gets involved in that, has a revolutionary quality to it. Because racism and American and the development of American capitalism are intertwined. Mm-hmm. Always have been, from slavery on through to Jim Crow, on to now when we still have segregation. People ask why after 500-600 years we haven't been able to eliminate racism, so because it's linked to capitalist profits, power, division of the working class, and all those things. And so people don't think they're revolutionaries when they're just talking about a simple thing like the right to drink at a water fountain. Mm, but that was a revolution. That was a popular revolution that took place in the South. All those 5 million people who escaped, that was part of the revolution. You know, the boss will wake up one morning, go to the factory or go to the fields, and they weren't there. They went. They went on strike.
Workers
they took
on strike.
took a little weekend trip.
Now, Ansel becomes, you become involved in politics. You run for vice president.
Right.
72, 76. And she runs for president.
She runs right after me.
Right after you.
In 80 and 84.
And she's continued her membership. So
she's not a member now.
She's not a member.
No.
Okay.
91 with the Great Collapse.
91. Okay.
She was one of those who dropped from the party.
Okay. What happened in 91 then?
When the Soviet Union collapsed.
Right, so she...
So people felt like...
Parted...
If we can't win here in the United States, one of the reasons it's possible is that the Soviet Union would just grow so into such a comprehensive, beautiful, democratic, and socialist society that people here would be more inclined to do the same. And when the Soviet Union collapsed, a lot of people felt that there was actually... Not just that model, which I argue was that model. It wasn't just that model. They were saying that the whole theories, all the theories and political
was wrong
understanding,
too.
All that was wrong.
So
the party, the people left the party quite a bit, got a few people. But enough stayed, and I would say it was probably a 50-50 split. The enough stayed and built that we rebuilt the party pretty much across the country. But it never got to the size that it was back then. It never did.
Okay, and I guess let's backtrack a little bit here. So 72, 76, you run for vice president.
Right.
And how with Gus Hall?
With Gus Hall.
As president, our president candidate. How was that? What was that experience? What did you find out as you campaigned there?
Well, we had a theory. We had an understanding from our practices in the trade union movement and civil rights movement, women's movement, all these other things that we were involved in, that there was actually, the American people were more radical and more anti-capitalist than the authorities thought.
Absolutely.
And so running for president and vice president, the highest office in the land, we never thought we could win, of course, but we did thought we could influence the debate, and we also thought we could build the party by letting people know this is a real kind, not some caricature not some I led three lives nonsense, you know, not some hate-filled, you know, automaton of Moscow. But we had real people, real working people and so forth. So we ran a working class team, myself and Gus Hall. Gus was a steel worker. I was a printer and a factory worker, union guys all the way, union all the way. And, you know, we didn't get a lot of votes, but I think we had a terrific impact on showing us as being part of the...
Creating the narrative that needed to be heard.
Thank you.
No, and so then Angela runs and expands the party.
Well, actually, the party expanded in the defense of Angela. Because they went too far. You know, Richard Nixon said that Angela Davis was a terrorist and that she ought to be hunted down. That they love that phrase, hunted down and prosecuted for her being involved, and she was not involved, as we know. Right. The jury was unanimous when we finally got a trial. She voluntarily came back. She was in New York to meet with her attorney to turn herself in, but they knew where she was, and they were waiting for her to commit a crime so they could add that on. You see, there she was smarter than that. And she came back, but they got her at a hotel, Howard Johnson, right on 8th Avenue downtown, and they took her into jail, and they flew her to California under extraordinary, it was like they had the Adolf Hitler or somebody in there, you know. It was horrible. But here was somebody who was a brilliant scholar.
Right.
Angela spoke Spanish, French, German, studied in the Sorbonne, studied in Germany, and was just a brilliant scholar. And of course, she had all the cultural accoutrements with the Afro and all of that, and she was a great speaker. And they just messed with the wrong person. And ultimately, we were able to win a movement to get her bail. And when I say we, the communists really were in the forefront, but we never closed the door to other people and get involved. And there were committees all across the country, all across the world, communists, socialists, Democrats, liberals, all kinds of people joined in because they saw the importance of the right of communists in the United States in terms of strengthening democracy for all. Around the world. And it was linked to ending the war in Vietnam. All of those things came together very nicely, and we had quite an explosion of membership there. And as a result, you know, Angela agreed to run for vice president with Gus in 80 and 82. But by then, Ronald Reagan had won, and the right danger just—it got 100 times more dangerous, and correctly so. And he said about civil rights, the time has passed. Mm. He did that thing in Philadelphia, Mississippi, where they killed the three. His second term, he started his campaign in Philadelphia, Mississippi, where they killed Turner, Swerner, and Goodman and Cheney, and they It was just the signs were ominous. And so the votes for the communists actually went down.
Right.
With Angela. She had a bigger voice, no question, but the votes went down. Mm. But nevertheless, played an important role in this whole effort. The labor movement changed as a result of Reagan and got more radical. The Meanies and the Kirklands and Lovestone and all the old coal warriors were basically...
Deindustrialization.
All those things changed. It just sparked
the economy,
up the
finance.
And you had a whole new thing, which by the turn of the century and so forth, you had a new leadership with John Sweeney and now Trump. Trump has played an incredible role in 08 and 12 in the election of Obama, calling on workers to fight racism. I mean...
And so what are you... graciously gave me this pamphlet that you wrote, Black Lives Matter. So you're... Here you are relating to a movement that just is only 2 or 3 years old.
Yeah.
So again, make the connections here. Communist Party, Black Lives Matter, racism, exploitation of human beings.
One thing I can tell you, Jim, is that the levels of consciousness of the American people, particularly young people, and particularly racially oppressed young people, is just moved to such a high level. These young people, without access to, you know, great theory and communist leadership, you might say.
Right.
But they, they drew their own conclusions, and they did get some of that, no question about it. But they drew their own conclusions about the society, something wrong with it, doesn't respond to us.
From their individual experiences, just as you did.
Yeah, they had, yeah. But at a stage when capitalism had actually reached a higher stage of crisis, because you didn't have, you know, you had imperialism, but what is that word they use for transnational corporations and so forth? Global capitalism.
Okay,
is like imperialism on crack. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
They were going crazy, and even the economic policy that grew out of a Reagan era, the big turn was then, where they in fact found a way to jail all these people on trumped up drugs. Really, they
the drug drugs war, starting again with Nixon.
Yeah, but they accelerated with the Reagan administration. Democrats played along with that.
Yep.
Clinton, unfortunately, was part of that. And they, when you had all of that coming, caving in on people, people aren't stupid. They really are not. They really, like the ladies in the beauty shop, had no theory on. They understood that something was going in the wrong direction. And those black youth who went out and led this movement, and it became a national movement, it still is.
Mm-hmm.
And they still had some lessons that there could be some maturation to be done. All movements does, certainly our movement does. But they understood that they wanted to fight. And they went out and they carried out tremendous battles around the murders of Trayvon, around the Garner case here, and Michael Brown. It's just tremendous what they have done to contribute to the fight for democracy and against racism, and educate. Because if you went to those demonstrations, some people say they were mainly black youth. They may have been mainly a lot of white youth and white older people and black older people participating in it. There's your vanguard. You know what I'm saying?
And help us understand the necessity for organization. Where does organization come in on this? Where does the party, in other words, channeling this energy and
well, you can have all the best ideas in the world.
Yeah.
And the most brilliant thinking. But if you cannot find a way to carry them out, and if you cannot find a path to implementing your proposals around change, you know, when I ran in 72, we proposed a $12 minimum wage. But the labor movement didn't adopt that. They weren't ready to adopt. We called for shortest work week, down to a 35-hour and a 30-hour work week, that would then create new jobs. With no cut in pay, we called for it. Mm-hmm. It would create new jobs and so forth. The press went wild. Well, you're crazy. This can't happen. Blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
And now it's a $15 wage was just passed. It's going to be implemented here in New York and California, and Seattle was the first city to do it, and it's going to spread all over. And You gotta be able to challenge certain capitalist, you know, priorities or priorities of the capitalist class, the privileged position that they hold. Don't give me any trouble. I give you your check. You work for me, and if I don't like you, I'll kick you the hell out of here in a minute. You know that kind of arrogance. I gotta make my profit, or else I won't give you a job, and you won't have anything. And people saying, "Oh, that's I've had enough of that." McDonald's workers. Burger King, the low-paid workers, are now leading the labor movement in a lot of ways. They are part of transforming the labor movement to a more militant, fighting mm-hmm. labor movement. And we're
service,
in there. We're service. Part of all of that.
You're in, right.
Yeah, we're not out of that. We're not out of that. If you read the pamphlet, you'll
I
see.
Will. I will.
You know. And our last event, you know, we had elected officials come to our last New York event, a Better Worlds Award. Around the country, that's true. Labor leaders come and so forth. Some of the victims of police repression have come. And so on. And so we had a magazine, a newspaper called The People's World, which you can get online, and you can see it is a chronological journal of the whole struggle, the democratic struggle of our people. And communists are not opposed to democracy or democratic struggle. That is the biggest bald-faced lie that was started by Hitler and continues to be a mainstay for the ultra-right in our country today.
Okay. And just curious, have you seen Michael Moore's new movie?
Yes.
Brilliant. Okay, so now tell me the obvious progressive, much more progressive lives that are being lived in these European and other states where they have a much more humane welfare state.
Right.
Now, is that, we're not home yet. We're not to full socialism. We're not to communism, correct?
Mm-hmm.
So what would you see necessary for the party to be trying to accomplish, let's say in Denmark or in some of the countries that they... Right.
Well, the workers in Denmark have...
Where do we go from here?
Yeah, they have problems as well. The poor are taken care. They have unemployment compensation until you get a job, a lot of those countries.
Right.
Now, let me just say historically, when the Eastern European countries went socialist and put in socialist measures that had to do with employment, guaranteed housing, guaranteed health care, education, all those things that they put forward, it put a lot of pressure on the European democracies or capitalist countries to impose these measures, to fight for those measures as well. And they're all under attack right now, but the workers are fighting back. And now with this European Union and all the economic shenanigans and pain and suffering that they have caused, these things are under. They don't want any reforms like that anymore. But
so you're still, in a sense, even in these social democracies, they're still, in a sense, a master-slave relationship.
Because the means of production
is still not in the hands.
Yeah, some of it is
workers' cooperatives and whatever you want to call them.
But still, the basic economy is still run by the capitalist class. But see, that's, you say we mature, you learn.
Right.
You know, the truth is that capitalists aren't stupid. And when they see that a society is moving in a direction that would threaten their very existence, they'll make concessions.
Right.
And that's why we always have to have a movement and strong labor and strong people's movement, strong civil rights, the strong fight for against racism and for peace and so forth, because you can force them over. And
where are we most progressive right now in terms of your vision of communism? Where in the world? What country can we point to more?
Well, there's a bunch of them. You know, Vietnam is still basically a socialist country, even though they have partnerships, joint ventures, and so forth.
Right.
That they have, they say that the Soviet model was not adequate for them to change the standard of living of their people rapidly enough or to meet the needs of their people. So they open their economy up to foreign investment under certain restrictions. And by the way, they didn't have a strong enforcement on some issues, as we know. But at the same time, they're heading towards controlling that.
Okay.
And they're saying that they can uplift the standard of living of their people, and they have.
So there are examples around the world. Okay,
in our country, if we think that given the time the majority wants socialism, then I'm for that. Maybe you know,
we're moving forward with Bernie.
Bernie's doing a great job.
Tell us, we only have a couple more minutes. Tell us how to get hold of you, and where the
I just want to say one thing.
Please.
On Bernie.
Sorry.
The Daily News. They were a bunch of attacks on him in the Daily News. Read the article in the Huffington Post, which exposes the fraud of what they're attacking Bernie. He didn't know what he was doing. He didn't know how to make the changes.
He wasn't as aggressive and all that? Is that what you're saying?
No, they were saying that Bernie calls for free education. He calls for taking over the banks, but he doesn't know how to do it. Not true. But you can reach us at 235 West 23rd Street in Manhattan. That's our headquarters, 7th floor. You can reach us online. Just put in there People's World or the Communist Party USA in the Google, and you can get hold of us. And our membership is wide open. We are people joining. We have a very multiracial, young and old membership. There is a young Communist League in New York. And
on campuses, various campuses?
They have some campuses. We're really rebuilding still, but we're on some campuses, and with the help of a lot of people who think like us, we can change that.
And you have major events.
Yes. Now I'm going to tell you people to go to the demonstration on the 14th, which is around the $15 minimum wage. We're going to be there now, as well as thousands of other people. In the coming period, we have no big affairs unless you want to come to my retirement party.
I don't quite see you ever retiring,
I am not really retiring, but I'm not.
I can't see it. I'd like to come anyway.
Okay. That'll be in July. But one correction I want to make is that I'm not executive vice chair anymore. I am now chairman of New York Party. But I have retired from full-time office participation. I am now emeritus.
Well, listen, this has been fascinating. It's been incredibly informative, and I love your energy. I love meeting you, and I want to thank you so much, Jarvis, for appearing this evening on The Radical Imagination. We'll see you next Sunday. Take care, everyone. Good night.